All right, I will call our meeting to order. This is the morning part of the April 26th meeting of the Salt Spring Local Trust Committee. I'm Sheila Malcolmson. I'm the committee chair. On my left, your local trustees, Peter Grove and George Grams. On my right, our planning manager, Leah Hartley. Our planning clerk, Claire Olivier, who I'm going to invite to introduce our new minute taker, Catherine Luton. I'm very glad to have you here and turn it over to Claire.
Yes, good morning, everyone. It's with great pleasure that we introduce Catherine Luton, who is our contract minute taker. Catherine's face will become quite familiar to you as she now will take part in most meetings that we'll be conducting. Welcome, Catherine.
Welcome. Glad to have you here. And want to acknowledge the great work we've had in the service of minute takers Mary Hughes and Kate Mary. And we're going to have some backup from
Mary,
Hughes.
Yes.
But welcome. And we'll don't be afraid to slow us down. We're going to do our best to propose resolutions slowly and thoughtfully, and we really are meant to be writing them down, and so we'll still say them, but pass you a copy. But if you haven't, if you're not with us, please don't be afraid to interrupt, get my attention, and we'll slow it down. Well, thanks and welcome. And thanks for the introduction and all the support. Claire plays a vital behind-the-scenes role in managing all the minutes of that we see. It all comes to us tidied up, so thank you for that. I want to acknowledge also that we're meeting on the traditional territory of Coast Salish people and thank them for their historic stewardship. And move into our business meeting. Approval of the agenda is our second item, and we've got just one proposal from staff as a late item addition. This is for 10.1 material provided to the Trust Committee by one of the delegates, which is the Salt Spring Island SPCA. So this has got a date of April 26 on it. By consent, are the trustees happy to add this to 10.1 on the agenda?
Yes, certainly.
Are there any other items for the trustees to add?
I have none.
Okay. Anything from the planning staff?
No.
By consent, then, can we adopt the agenda as amended? Thank you. Our first item of business, then, is the draft minutes of March 15 at 3.1, page 1 of the agenda. Anybody have changes to propose on page 1?
I do not.
Page 2?
Nope.
Page 3?
Nope.
I had a question on page 3 at the top. In 4.2, it says the second sentence, the local trust committee will seek clarification. But that seems unlikely that we would have said the LTC. Does trustees remember, was that something that individual trustees were going to pursue, or were we asking staff to do this?
Where are we?
4.2 at the top of page 3, okay. The second sentence. This is something that was in the draft minutes of the Agriculture Advisory Commission that raised questions. It says the LTC will seek clarification, but the LTC can't really do that itself.
Mm-hmm.
Does that ring any bells?
I'm afraid it doesn't to me, no.
It doesn't ring a bell to me either, I'm afraid.
Yeah. From the planning staff on that one?
I believe it was it was mentioned at the meeting, and it was general consensus of the three members that in the minutes was something that would benefit from clarification. It was not a decision made by resolution, though, so it perhaps could read the trustees or Salt Spring trustees.
Okay. I'll revisit the minutes and try and throw some light on that, and I'll raise anything necessary with the
Okay, super. That's great. So we'll just say trustees instead of local trust committee. That way we'll have a bit more confidence that it might actually be done. Because it wasn't in the follow-up action list, which suggests that it wasn't something that we asked staff to do. And that's maybe something helpful. This is a sidebar, but for the minute taker, we do try to make sure we're only saying the local trust committee did something when there's a resolution that indicates that. it's more likely otherwise, if it's something conversational, it's more likely that we'll say the trustees discussed or, but we'll deal with those as we come to them. Anything else on page 4 or 5?
No.
Page 6 or 7?
I have nothing.
No.
I had a question also on page 6. Top of the page, the final paragraph of 11.6, the final sentence. It was noted that the recommendations of the advisory design panel were not supported by the local trust committee. And that's also something that just looks like we wouldn't say that unless the trust committee had passed a resolution saying that it didn't support. So I'm just a little bit, especially because we haven't made a decision yet on this file, I'm a little bit uncomfortable about that wording, and I wondered if the planning staff had any advice on that.
That may be correct. Similar rationale with the last one. If it was said by more than one, you'd want to pluralize it, but it perhaps is not a resolution or meant to be relayed as a decision of LTC.
Yeah.
I was not in attendance at this one, so
right.
I'll leave it for you.
Any sense from the trustees as to what you'd like to do? We could even just say that we discussed the recommendations of the ADP, or if you'd like to say something stronger, I could say we're not supported, or we're not entirely supported, or...
Well, I think it actually reflects what we said. We didn't feel that they were, those recommendations were necessarily essential. I'm not sure that it was a motion. There certainly was no motion. I think it was a general discussion.
Is that your recollection that none of the recommendations were something that you were likely to support?
Well, I remember that Stefan, and perhaps my memory is less than accurate, but I seem to remember that Stefan suggested that the changes proposed at the last meeting were in compliance in general terms with the basic framework of the development permit and meeting form and character. I can't remember anything specifically that we observed in the design panel's recommendations that we took issue with.
One way to do this would be simply to delete that sentence, because it is pretty strong for something that we haven't actually taken a vote on or made a final decision on, and it's not necessary.
Yeah, I think that's
true.
Maybe we'll just take extra care when this application does come back to make sure that we do get wording that's represents the. So are people fine with removing that sentence?
Because it is. I mean, it wasn't all the recommendations that we talked about. That makes it sound as if it was all their recommendations. So I guess the point, I mean, better to remove it completely. I think you're right.
All right. So thanks. So that sounds like a consensus to remove that sentence, and we'll make sure that when we do come back to the application that we get some clear wording in there. And I did have this is a question for the follow-up action list. On the very final page, page 8, 14.2, there's a reference to work around community-to-community forum, which isn't reflected in the follow-up action list. So that just may be something to capture so it doesn't get lost. So no change to the minutes there.
No.
Are there any final changes to propose? Can I take it by consent that the March 15 minutes are adopted as amended?
You may.
Yes. Thank you. The April 5 minutes, anybody have changes on the, say, the first 3 pages?
I have none.
No, I have no changes either.
Page 12, 13, or no changes at all in the whole document?
No, I have none.
Okay. The planning manager?
On page 12, I've noted that there's a word missing. It's in the final sentence of item 12.3. And I think if you were, as you read it, you note that there's a word that's missing. So I propose that you might want to say that last sentence should read, and as potential climate change funding with work program items. Sorry. And it's that matches potential climate change funding with work program items.
So in between funding and work, we're inserting the word with. That's more clear. Okay. Thanks. And that should probably be a follow-up action list item as well. I don't think it's on there now. Any changes on page 13? 14?
And
oh, 13.
I'm sorry. No, it is on page 14. Mm-hmm. I'm sure.
Any changes to propose?
Yes.
Planning manager?
It's been noted that there's an error in transcribing bylaw numbers. And this would be in the fourth paragraph on page 14, where the resolution cites bylaw number 457, which you'll see has already been dealt with two paragraphs up or two resolutions up. So this was dealing with three bylaws, and this one would have been 459, bylaw 459. So
that's resolution SSI 080-12. On the second line, it should read 459 in place of 457?
Correct.
Thanks. And that lines up with a staff recommendation in the report, so
that is
correct. I'm confident that.
And actually, the next resolution, you can see that we're citing correctly the four, there are the three bylaw numbers.
Great. The trustees fine with that?
Yes.
We usually don't make any changes to resolutions, but this is just a typo, it looks like. I had just on the very final thing on page 15, it says recorded instead of recorder. We can change that. Any other changes at all? Can I take it by consent that the minutes of the April 26th Trust Committee meeting are adopted as amended?
You may.
Thank you. And we've got no resolutions without meeting under 3.3. And so we'll move on page 17 of the agenda into item 4.1, which is the staff report on the Local Trust Committee work program for 2012-14. And I'll turn it over to the planning manager to present your report briefly, and then we'll go to any clarification questions from the trustees. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And this report is intended to provide the basis for establishing a three-year work program for operational reporting purposes, and also to give a bit of a sense as to priorities that you will wish to prepare for and align staff resources with over the course of a three-year term of office. We have received since January four reports which lead to this one, and essentially it was an introduction of a long list of proposals which had been put forward in previous term of office and through interest of agencies or members of the public in the community. We then spent some time thinking about how to evaluate different proposals and competing priorities. Began that process at about the same time as receiving confirmation of the budget for the first of the 3 years. And then at last meeting, beginning a dialogue around prioritizing. So this report is provided as a synthesis of some of those. It's a short report, but hopefully can stand on its own merit. I should note, without getting into too much of the details on this, because people will have recognized much of the content. I should note that this is an important exercise in which LTC will want good staff advice about setting appropriate expectations within the community. And upon recognition of constraints on resources and budget, you'll want to make sure that your top priorities are dealt with first. So it's a bit of a balancing act. A good question, I think, has been asked of whether this is too ambitious a work program. And I'll suggest that, yes, it would not be feasible to do justice to all of the items shown in Table 2 and Table 3 in the course of a term of office. From my perspective, by indicating a long list, you have indicated to the community that you are interested in pursuing these things, and you are remaining somewhat open to responses from the community as to where they see some partnerships that they can enter into with you. And you are also, I think, indicating that to undertake all of these things, there needs to be very careful attention to scope of work and scale of the exercise made right at the beginning, so that there's clear expectation of how many resources, how much of an initiative this is going to be, what are the real true objectives of the LTC before getting into this. And I think that's recognizing that once you get into something by participation of the community, you will receive a lot of input, and it's sometimes difficult to gauge right at the start that which is going to draw a lot of input and perhaps become larger versus that which is going to receive very little input from the community and simply be viewed as more of an administrative matter. So if these were all to become matters of keen interest within the community, you would not do justice to all of this. On the other hand, I think that it is worth starting in on things with a bit of an ambitious work plan. It certainly shows the community where you have interest in moving. The one other thing that I think you will quickly learn getting into it is that from an organizational perspective, we will always encourage you just to be looking at your top priorities at any one time. So not taking on a new venture, even if it's the right season, if there's outside funding for it, something like that, to always be saying, well, if it's timely to take that on, then what are we prepared to put aside for the moment? And to say, maybe we've gone as far as we can on that, and it needs to be put aside while we put something else in. The other maybe important message that we learned last year is that when we are at full staff and when we have an experienced LTC, we run the risk of getting ahead of the community. And so as we say, keep top three priorities or no more than five, I think that resonates quite well with the community of we can't be talking 10 different things at the same time. We can't have a meaningful discussion on 10 different things at the same time. What is it that LTC wishes us to talk about this month and to think about? And it's not a thought process that works in 5 days or in maybe even in 5 weeks. It's something of, if you want to engage the community on something in a meaningful discussion, there needs to be an introduction to it. There needs to be some time for community members to think about it and to respond meaningfully. And then for you to take both staff advice and take input and deliberate around this table and make steps forward. If you're thinking of any of these that engage the community as, you know, at least 2 months of that discussion, you really don't want to have more than three discussions open at the same time. I I think, is our experience. So I'll just offer some of those probably important messages that we will always come back to in this work program. I think those are some of the foundations on which you can start in on a work program ambitious, but also take note of the experience of other LTCs and other local governments. This is not confined to Islands Trust, to really just take things in sequence, deal with one at a time. So the report talks about staff resources, it talks about financial resources, and then it provides two tables with table two in here being the top and the highest priorities, which from previous discussion we anticipate that you will want to at least begin taking a look at the scope of work in this fiscal year in 2012. And table three are items that you are prepared to just defer until next year. We're in a tight program budget this year. So these in table three are things that you may think about in the fall, attaching some budget to, and moving on to next year's list. But certainly through this table two, you would want staff to be focused on items in table two in terms of the resourcing and the budget preparations for this fiscal year. Timing of things on table two, you would take on, perhaps in accordance with the staff comments of which quarter you would take them on, but again, you would not take a new initiative on until you had completed one of your top five priorities. I think that speaks to that slide. Behind the scenes, we as staff take the information from this report and we have a little Gantt chart that allows us to identify which staff we think might be lined up for which of these initiatives. In which quarter, and staff have participated in taking a look at these things, are kind of comfortable with, yes, I think that we could take on the LUB technical amendments when we have finished the industrial land use, or the industrial task force recommendations, that sort of thing. I've not got the Gantt chart here in your report. If you wish a copy of this following your deliberations today and your resolutions today, we can provide you a copy. But the resolutions that are in front of you essentially go about giving a nod at least to the 2012 and put forward a three-year work program which helps Islands Trust itself knowing where it thinks that Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee will want to be focused over the 3 years. But definitely gives a nod to what you think you will get on the table this year, at least as a start. With that, I think those are probably enough comments from me. I see on the overhead here, I've got the thoughts on use of grants, volunteers, and contractors. That's perhaps an important discussion for us to have in light of the work program. Is there a way, this is a question that often comes up, is there a way for an LTC to supplement its work program and take on perhaps six or seven initiatives at the same time by use of a grant program or that may fund a contractor or that may fund volunteers? I think we need to emphasize that anything that is on the LTC work program draws resources of the Salt Spring Planning Office. It requires staff oversight to accept a grant, to do the reporting on a grant. And to provide the communication of Islands Trust and on behalf of LTC with respect to that work. So it is not possible to do something as an LTC initiative without somehow drawing on staff resources. Those are staff resources that will be drawn away from the top five priorities if you attempt to put additional work on. There's no additional work for free. I'm not suggesting that you shy away from grants or partnerships of volunteers. I think that there is a way that those allow you to supplement a work program, allow you to bring in specialist expertise, thought, components. It allows you to enter into partnerships or to foster partnerships with groups that perhaps have not been involved in the past. So I'm not suggesting that you shy away from it. I think that there is a way to complement your work program through the use of grants and volunteers and partnerships, but that should always be accounted for in your top five priorities. And I think that really is all I have to say on this.
Thanks. Questions or clarification from trustees?
If we look at Table 2, the first thing I would comment is why we have two separate issues for affordable housing and farm workers' housing. Aren't they essentially part and parcel of the same issue, dealing with affordable housing and different segments or sectors of the community? And that, if that's the case, shouldn't that list be of four items rather than five? Because if we're restricted, for example, for this is our top five priority list, it's going to severely constrain my ambitions. Now, I don't want to overstretch trusts or the staff's capacity by any manner of means, but I would hope that we could examine other issues within the community, and this might be an appropriate time at which we discuss, for example, the sewage event and how we accommodate that if it isn't on the top five priority list, and it isn't. It could be argued that it's part of the community engagement programme, but the only answer I can see is if I can't do that through the local trust committee, then I would have to instigate some initiatives as a trustee, and I'm prepared to do that in community partnerships without drawing on staff time. But I think it's probably crucial that we identify which specifically those top five are, so that we ring fence staff's time on those, and we're aware as trustees what limits we've placed on that, so that it becomes personal issues rather than local trust committee issues.
Yes, I hear you, Trustee Grahams, and share your concerns. The fourth page, or back page, page 22, under recommendations, that actually breaks this down and specifies what the top priorities are as of right now. And we've got the RAR, which is mapping, and we're certainly involved with that, and so it's certainly on the table right now, as is secondary suites. The three other items, video recording, advisory committee, and the community engagement pilot. Now, I do understand your need to limit it to five. The video recording pilot, though, I consider to be part of the community engagement pilot. So not only that, I would hope that the video recording pilot and evaluation is something that we can put to bed fairly soon. Mm-hmm. So if video recording is part of community engagement, that reduces our list to four. Under community engagement, Trustee Grahams mentioned a sewage program, which will be referred to later, I believe. But that also is part of the community engagement pilot. I mean, I do understand the need to number these and sort them and have them in an orderly fashion. But we don't want to restrict ourselves too much. So can we jig around with that list of 1 through 5 so that we can comply with your requirement to have only 5 items?
Can I give another perspective on which might help the conversation a little bit? My sense is that Salt Spring has drifted away from this practice a little bit, but my own experience, the other islands, and Gabriel is the best, you know, the next largest and busiest island next to Salt Spring, how the work program is intended to be used is you review it every month,
right,
and it tells the staff what you as trustees want them to work on as their first priorities for until the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So you can certainly do, you know, a big picture. This is the trust committee's ambition for the whole term, and that may have those very big picture, more community engagement, changes to affordable housing, whatever, big picture. But to me, the beauty and the control of being very specific in the top priority list is that it's crystal clear to the staff what you expect of them, and you're not going to be surprised when your top priority item didn't get done over the next 3 weeks or over the next 6 weeks, because you've given something very specific. So, for example, if the work with the Agricultural Land Commission around farm worker housing is, it is a distinct issue because it's a particular part of the bylaw and it's a particular agency you're going to be working with, it may well get lost if you lump it with a much bigger objective. And I'm always tempted to do this too. Let's bundle things into as broad categories so we can get as many on the list. But I just really reaffirm a few more times that the more specific you can be so far as what your near-term objectives, the more control you have as to outcomes and the more clear staff are. And even though I think our staff make great decisions, have good judgment, it may very well be that if what you say is affordable housing, they may choose one of 20 things within that, unless you give quite clear directions.
So I would taking those recommendations 1 through 5, I mean, I would have little A, little B. So under community engagement, we'd have little A, video recording pilot, little B, and little C, there's going to be possibly 2 or 3 items that are going to come up as a consequence of today's meeting. I think they should be itemized, and so that we don't lose sight of them, so that indeed when we talk about affordable housing, we can identify just what we're talking about, you know, whether it includes farm workers housing or not. So yeah, we don't want to lose sight of things by bundling them up together, I agree.
And I do suggest that you revisit it often, and then you get rewarded by saying, okay, video project is done. We can now say, as a trust committee, we have achieved this one thing. It's off the list. Something moves up. I do think it's really helpful to have your items 6 and down prioritized so that the community has got a sense of when you finish one thing, what's going to be the next that gets worked on. But I think it's also really helpful to signal that, as the planning manager says, there's when we try to do everything simultaneously and when you don't really prioritize, it just, it's confusing for the public, it's and for staff, and it's frustrating for us politically at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. I certainly like the idea, and I have actually suggested that we not stop the list at 5. We can say fine, the top 5 are the ones we're working on right now, but I'd like to see a list that goes through, you know, to 10 or whatever it is, so that people know what's on the list, and rather than a sort of a general wish list as appears in Table 3. So I would like to suggest that we work on this for our next meeting. And
when we last discussed this, my memory was that the local trustees were going to do that prioritization individually.
Which we did.
Did that happen? So
yes.
Do you have numbers associated with what you're... Great.
Yes.
Do we want to talk about those now? We've got 40 minutes set aside for this conversation, and I think if we were able to put numbers beside the next items, it would be clarifying.
Yeah.
Of the Table 2 items, do either of you have a sense of what numbers you would put so far as ranking beside these? Or, and are there any missing?
No, I mean, I've worked through it and I've made my comments, and I think from that point of view, it indicates what my far-sighted vision is in terms of priorities. And at the moment, it can remain stuck to the wall. I agree that we have to deal with our top five priorities, but I think we can. I don't see why it's not possible to have other initiatives that we're either as trustees looking to the community for, or that are initiated within the community in advance of them hitting the agenda. It's not as if, community planning, any one of these can be ring-fenced. They're all interrelated, and they all impact on each other. So it's not as if we can take one item, such as an OCP review, and say that's all we have to do, because it's impacted by so many of the other factors that are on the list. Almost having them like Skittles doesn't suggest that interrelatedness of community planning. I don't know what the answer is, but I see it as a problem just in the structure of saying, okay, let's tackle these one or two items at the moment and ignore the rest.
Yeah. We can't be that neat and tidy, but in order to try to achieve that, I would take this list 1 through 5. I would include video recording, as I've said, as part of a community engagement pilot. That could be community engagement little one. We then need to move some things onto the current list. I mean, we are in the process of looking at industrial land, for instance. I mean, I don't want that. If we don't put it on this current list, does it mean it goes away? And I happen to know that it's being worked on. Stefan is working on it. So we don't want to remove that from our current list. We have a specific invitation from the ALC to talk about farm workers' housing. I certainly don't want to put that off into next year or in the unforeseeable future. We have an invitation, and I think we should follow up on it. Now, just because it's not on our list 1 through 5, it doesn't mean we should ignore it. So, you know, I don't want this to be too restrictive, and I'm seeing it as being very black and white, and I don't think the world is black and white.
My experience, both from my own island and from Salt Spring last term, is that although everything is interrelated, if there wasn't an intention set at the beginning as to, if we have limited time and limited resources, this is the most important thing. You know, pretend you're in the final year of your term. You know, what's the stuff that has to be at the top of the list? To me, I love the planning manager's optimism, but I just find it very hard to imagine being able to finish even all the table 2 items. It adds up to something like 10 different bylaw amendments, it looks like to me, and we were only able to complete 2 in the previous term. So I think it would be helpful to have an entire list which can be reevaluated. To at least give some form of priority. So, for example, if what you ended up choosing as your number 5 or 6 was the Industrial Task Force, that the recommendations, that signals to staff that if they have time and there's something that they're waiting for on one of the top 5 items, then they'll move down to that number 6 item and do a little bit of work on it. Or they may well come back and say, look, you know, the ALC is going to be traveling on the Southern Gulf Islands 2 months from now, and so we're seeing that there's an opening, and this is something that we recommend that you move up your priority list, because we think we can achieve that meeting and we'll be able to get some advice on how to move forward. So it certainly can ebb and flow, and I certainly also appreciate what Trustee Grahams is saying around efforts that trustees may be doing in the background and community projects. Again, if an individual trustee has a sense of confidence that this particular item is the local trust committee's number seven priority, I think that would be enough of a signal to you as an individual or to community groups to put some resources and organizing into it.
Well, I think what we have to recognize as community priorities as well as local trust committee priorities. And I think that's the items that I wish to start opening a debate with the community before we even consider whether we need bylaw amendments. For example, let me take the issue of tourism. I've said that we need a tourism policy on Ireland. That doesn't mean to say that we need necessarily a bylaw, but we need a vision as to whether we accommodate tourism or whether we don't, because it impacts in so many other issues. It impacts in tourism, how we develop our town centre, it impacts in hotels, short-term vacation rentals, it impacts on what we do with our harbour and how we accommodate marine tourism. How can we have a vision for advancing our community without discussing tourism? Now, that doesn't mean to say that we're going to sit down and construct a bylaw, but at least we have to work with the community to decide if we accommodate it or if we don't. And if we don't accommodate it, then how do we transition our economy to a non-tourist-based one sustainably? These are huge topics that have to be discussed in the community before they even, I think, reach the agenda of consideration of a bylaw. And these are the big picture items that we have to start discussing with the community at large.
And George, I do agree with you wholeheartedly. I guess if I was sitting in the planning manager's seat, I'd think to myself, well, how do we do this? I mean, I think this, your tourism policy would be a terrific project. But how do we actually go ahead and do that? I mean, presumably we would have to engage the community. We would have to have community meetings. And that needs to be organized and administered. I mean, realistically, somebody needs to do that. And I think what we're hearing, that staff has limited time and resources, which is fair.
Okay, well, maybe I'm not understanding how that would be accommodated under the current structure. So how is this done at the moment? How do other islands or communities look at issues such as this and get them on the agenda in a way that the community can feel confident that we're dealing with it in a competent way, in a way that shares the responsibility and respects every stakeholder?
In my experience, the Trust Committee establishes the issue as a priority. It doesn't in advance say we think it's going to lead to a bylaw amendment, but it does it. It gives the issue and the community members who will engage in it the respect of adequately resourcing it so far as time, whether that's gathering materials that are available for community consultation, whether it's simply the admin staff supporting the community volunteer groups by providing support around facilities booking or advertising, anything. You know, my experience is just these trying to do these things off the side of the desk doesn't work well. So if how you want to characterize the Trust Committee's term is a focus on tourism and local economy, that is fantastic. I'm only arguing that be a very clear objective stated up front and that it not be crammed in with a whole lot of other simultaneous priorities. And it's just one of those things of discernment. You know, the capacity of the individual trustees, the capacity of community groups and volunteers to engage meaningfully, as well as the capacity to professionally support whatever the community dialogue is that wants to happen.
Well, I understand that. I see a difficulty insofar as I really believe there is a hunger in the community to debate these issues. And at the moment, there is a certain amount of frustration because the pace of discussion is limited to staff resources and these few topics. And I think we need a framework, and maybe it's working outside with other groups, if we can somehow assemble a system whereby this is a community initiative, rather than an LTC one, possibly, and somehow draw on the whole community's resources to begin these debates. It might be possible to advance them, but advance them I would like to try. Now, if it's not possible through the LTC, I really seriously think we have to look at methods out with it. But they are of burning community concern, in my view. And opening the debate is an important part of the community engagement dialogue.
Is this something that we can use outside groups to help us with? I mean, for instance, with regard to tourism at the Chamber of Commerce.
I'm not suggesting we become a tourist island. The view of the community that we don't encourage tourism might be what emerges, but I think we should have a consensus on what that might be. This is where we need to start discussing this thing collectively and consensually.
Trustee Grahams, I think it's a great idea. I'm simply arguing that if that is an LTC priority, and I think it's helpful if it ends up on high on the list.
It's not on the list at the moment.
Yeah, I know.
It needs to get there, but I understand.
If this is a way that you'd like to define your term, I think it is important to have it on the Trust Committee's priority list, and then the Trust Committee can decide how it's going to resource that and how it's going to carry it out. It doesn't mean that it can't happen at all. I'm just concerned that our Table 2 doesn't have a lot of spirit in it, frankly. And it doesn't, to me, really reflect what I heard both of you articulate at our first meeting about your objectives. And I think it's more helpful if we can describe two and a half years from now, what do you want to say that you've been able to achieve? And then develop a short list, take that out to the community for consultation and get some feedback on that about how it can be carried out, as well as whether the community still 6 months after the election shares your priorities. My only caution is that we try to do a little bit of everything and not do it all.
I understand that, I understand that there are housekeeping issues that we have to attend to, and the workings of the island depend on those. We have to deal with those, but I don't want to lose sight of the big picture items and the vision items. By being too myopic on these housekeeping items. And if we can somehow open up the big picture items for general discussion in the community, I think it would relieve a lot of the frustration that I'm sensing.
Because an awful lot of the issues, when you call them housekeeping, they are administrative matters. They are administrative matters which do need to be dealt with and which will take time and debate. Mm-hmm. But maybe, George, we can include this kind of thing under community engagement, and let's build that up and work on it. Maybe we do need to bring the town hall issue back to the table, and that's something I'll be referring to later. Okay. But we do need to look at these big picture items, and rather than just be focusing on the administrative issues, which have to be done.
Yes, they do.
Is administrative, are you thinking of that as application processing, or
yes,
something more?
Well,
like
partly. I think, for example, the we know where we are with the video recording. And I think I'm hoping that's a housekeeping issue that won't take much, and it's done and dusted, but maybe I'm missing something. And if that's the case, that'll fall off the list fairly quickly. And something else, because that to me is not a high priority. It's a high priority, we need to do it, but it shouldn't engage our attention for an extended period of time, in my view.
And the Advisory Committee Terms of Reference is another good example. It's something that needs to be tidied up and cleaned up, but it shouldn't be diverting us from more important issues.
And we have somebody working on it pro bono pretty much full time.
Right.
So I'm hoping it won't be a huge draw on staff resources, that it'll be a kind of hit and run basis. It'll need attention from time to time, but I might be, I don't want to misrepresent staff's duties and responsibilities in this, but that's my perception, and if I'm missing something, then please correct me.
I think my suggestion would be that at a big picture topics that you want to take on, if we can get a sense of what the trust committee's priorities are, then the second question is how to resource those. And I think, you know, if your prediction is right that some of these items that are on the top list fall off quickly, then that's great. Then it opens up staff time to support the trustees' work. If it isn't as quick, then it means that the trustees carry the ball for a little bit longer before they can expect staff resources. Mm-hmm. But I do think still it's going to be helpful to know, how do you want to characterize your term? Is it, you know, is the next most important thing the industrial task force recommendation implementation? Is it dialogue on tourism? And I know that they're interrelated, but in reality, you know, some discernment, I think, is really going to be helpful.
Oh, absolutely.
Outcomes. Yeah. Is it helpful to look at this list on table two and give it some ranking, so far as if you had to choose one between the other, what would you choose? And I'm concerned that the village planning whole topic isn't on this table two list at all, and I've heard it described as a current priority, not really something for year two or three. And the tourism conversation also isn't on this list. So are we able to give some direction on the next order of priorities when the things that are on the list, right, the top five list, have been completed?
Well, table two is it's not additional because it still has secondary suites on. So if we deal with secondary suites, then it shouldn't be on this table two, I would think.
It's got a comment as a current top priority.
Oh,
in
right,
its,
so it
in
does.
Its right.
Yeah. Okay. The industrial task force is essential. I think we have to conclude the dealing with the recommendations of the industrial task force. Affordable housing. We have the strategy in place.
Could I suggest on affordable housing, we might want to just go back to summary comments and look a little bit closer at what is suggested as the scope, and just take the time to say, yes, it's obvious that that needs a bylaw amendment, versus the first step is actually to understand a little bit more. On some of these, it may be that whereas staff believe that the next step is a bylaw amendment, until you have received a report on it, you may actually not be convinced that it's a bylaw amendment.
Mm-hmm.
And I know on affordable housing, the comments of the trustees on strategy, implement the strategy, may not be what's reflected in the comments here, which quickly goes to an amendment to the LUB.
And I think that, you know, for each of these, we're going to have that level of, you know, what is the work that could be done. But I'm really encouraging the trustees to look at a big picture level, the themes that have been coming up. I think that Trustee Grahams was sort of starting to go through some of them. Task force, I hear, is something that the work may well be substantially completed, and it's more of an implementation. And my sense from both of you is that you'd like to see. That work completed.
Sorry, which work?
Industrial.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Well, that's well on the way.
Yeah.
Can I suggest that maybe what I should do is put my thoughts on paper and circulate them, and then we can discuss the best means of perhaps reconciling reality with
the dream.
Yeah. That's because I have a number of big picture items like that I'd like to look at, and we can see perhaps if and how they can be assimilated.
I think that's a very good idea. That would be helpful.
So what we would hope is at our next meeting is that we would be able to tighten up this Table 2 and Table 3 list, so you're recognizing that the items may move around, that you'd be signaling both to staff and to the community what you're thinking of as a work plan for the term, and then looking for community feedback on that.
And hopefully we can make a decision as to whether the big picture items have to be discussed by stepping outside the LTC and by engaging the community rather more fulsomely in terms of partnerships with specific trustees as opposed to the LTC as a whole and staff.
And let's continue the ranking past merely the first five. I think the ranking needs to go through at least till, 10 or whatever. Yeah. But let's put them in order.
Yeah, I agree. Otherwise, I think it's going to be frustrating for everybody. We'll be raising expectations, but not necessarily with
satisfying them.
Yeah. I think it's worrying. So how would you like to sum this up for the minutes? It sounds like by consent, the trust committee would like, is it the local trustees, or are we going to delegate this to Trustee Grams?
Trustee Grams is going to prepare a view on the subject.
Yeah.
So we'll look to Trustee Grams to bring back a proposal.
Yes.
On a reordering of Table 2 and 3 for the Trust Committee's consideration at the next meeting?
Yes.
Great, thanks. And I don't think we need a resolution on that. We're not directing staff, but just so it's understood. And that's appreciated. Thank you.
Very much.
I'll just turn to the planning manager. Do you have any concerns or advice?
I'll note that the centralized record keeping of top three priorities will be compiled and reported out before your next meeting. Perhaps what is looked at first on that central reporting is the listing of top three priorities. And should the LTC, and maybe we can do this afternoon or later today after getting the verbal report on video recording pilot, I think we may be moving past the evaluation of the pilot into contract pretty quickly. So you may want to do a resolution reestablishing top priorities and taking that off the list and putting community engagement on that list or the industrial whichever. Mm-hmm. So okay. we can come back to that.
Okay.
So
thank
we're
you.
Going to get... let's just make sure that we come back to that, because I think we do want to confirm at least our top priorities. So maybe we can do that under 6.5.
You may want to do it after you've had trustee reports.
Right. Okay. Well, let's just make sure we do it by the end of the day.
Yeah.
13.3.
Yeah. Excellent.
13.3 would be good.
So by consent, can we amend the agenda to add as 13.3 work program priority list?
Yes, you may.
And that will remind us to actually pass a resolution at that point, and that will capture some of this.
Right.
And we'll leave the recommendations on page 22 of the staff report until we've got a sense of a priority list for the coming year?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you to the planning team for that.
Yeah. Thanks for your hard work.
Trustees. Yes.
And your patience.
Indeed. Well, we know what we're working on now, and there's no question that the planning staff have got their priorities, so we're not lingering at all. Secondary suites and RAR mapping is a good mouthful until the next meeting, in any case. If we can move to the follow-up action list, which is page 23 of the agenda. And trustees, how would you like to go through this? Do you have particular questions or areas of focus, or do you want me to ask the planning manager to simply give us highlights on what might have changed?
That would be most helpful.
Yeah, be helpful.
Yeah, because I haven't compared this with the last one. I've read it, but some sort of summary would be really
helpful. On page 23, anything that the planning manager wants to highlight as having changed since this was printed? No?
No. I'm sorry. That very first one, February 2010, I think we'll probably, if we could recognize that this record, when it was compiled 2 years ago, had three resolutions really captured into one. Two of those things have very much been completed already. So perhaps what we will do is we will break this particular record now into two things so that you can see what is remaining to be done. It's not that the whole thing is ongoing or still in abeyance.
Page 24, any updates or questions?
None.
Page 25, any questions or updates?
No.
Page 25, Trustee Grove.
After the planning manager, you had something to say?
Yeah, the very top one, page 25, you'll see in the development application log that we actually have an application in for 151 Rainbow Road. So the correspondence to Mr. Lyons, in actual fact, staff were in conversation with the proponent prior to the LTC and then following LTC, and it has obviously translated into submission of a zoning application. So with your consent, I would like to remove that from the follow-up action list, which then retains just the one item, the correspondence to Ms. Weston that you're still waiting.
Sounds good.
Trustee Grove, did you have a question on that one?
I believe that we should have an acoustic report on the Quinnell matter for next meeting.
I received it late last night and immediately distributed it. So I emailed a copy to Peter and to Leah, and I would note that it was a draft copy. So I'm guessing that it was sent as soon as he received it. But I think we should request the final copy rather than the draft, and then of course it requires staff processing before it comes to the LTC. So the next meeting, I guess, is when it will be considered.
Okay. So we'll keep this on here, and it's delivered. Yes, it would be the complete report that is being sought.
Mm-hmm.
I had just a flag for the February 23 item around procurement policies. Mm-hmm. That I guess, depending on the scope of work, may be a work program item. So maybe one of those things that we need to prioritize. So I'll just flag that for the planning manager's advice. And I guess a flag for the trust committee that even though we've got it on this list, it might not be done unless we give it priority.
Yeah.
The next page, 26, any questions or updates?
On page 26 are the decisions of LTC from April 5th, so page 26 and 27, and you'll see that half of those, or more than half now, are done, as you would expect.
In the middle of the page, the annual report has probably been submitted. By now, I would imagine.
Yes. I'm not sure why that hasn't. It definitely has been submitted.
Okay. That's a check then. Great. Okay. Anything on page 27? Any questions?
No. Where were any work plans with regard to mapping?
The RAR mapping?
The RAR mapping.
It was in the previous minutes, but I guess we didn't give particular direction.
Should it not be on here somewhere?
It's July 7th, 2011.
Okay. So
Now, so July 7th was the instrumental one that says, with respect to RAR, working with community organizations and advisory committees, that discussion led to the pilot mapping, which would have been in ensuing months. I mean, you don't have a report back yet on that pilot mapping, so I'll have to. It's a good question why that one is off.
Well, so this is where this is kind of another formatting thing. This is where it would be good for us to have the work program on every agenda, because we would go through the follow-up action list, which is the little fiddly
right.
stuff,
right.
and then we would have our five-point list,
right.
and then that would be the opportunity for the trustees to say, oh, yeah, RAR mapping is our number one. What's the update on that?
Yeah.
So that's distinct from the follow-up action list, because it would simply have been the trustees direct the staff to issue a request, a RFP on mapping,
right.
for example. And then once that's done, it falls off the list, but it's the work program that reminds us each month to ask for status reports on those items. And that should be a standing item on our agenda.
So could we make sure there's a report for our next meeting?
Yeah. Yep. So maybe just ask that the minutes show that we'd like to have the work program print out as a standing item on future agendas.
Sorry, as a which item?
Standing item.
Standing.
Thank you. And I think that what we heard in the minutes from the last meeting was the planner saying that he was going to have the RAR report for us in 6 weeks from the last meeting. So I guess it would be on our next agenda.
It's in the May.
Yes. May agenda.
Coming forward in the May meeting.
Yeah. Probably
documents, though.
Anything else on follow-up action list? Oh, I guess I had one. The task that we gave to Trustee Grove about the gas tax application at the last meeting, that would ordinarily have been on our follow-up action list, so I'm kind of putting you on the spot. Do you have any report or update for the Trust Committee about whether you're recommending that we pursue it?
Well, Elizabeth White has worked with Victoria staff looking at gas tax applications and funding available. She had thought, as I had, when we first made the suggestion, that such an application for funds could be made by an organization or a society from the island. But it appears that it has to be made from the government, a form of a level of government. So she put together a good report setting out the sorts of things that we could pursue, dealing with water issues and sewage issues, and a draft budget. But sent it back to the trust saying that the application would need to come from the trust. We looked at it and realized that, and this all had to be done by the end of May, by the way. We looked at it and realized that it was impractical, if not impossible, to consider putting together the kind of a proposal which hadn't been formulated between now and the end of May. So we've had to say that it physically can't be done, and that's as far as we've come.
Right. So that was a request to the Trust Committee, so it's great that you're reporting back to us. Trustee Grahams, any reflections or advice?
Is this an appropriate time to mention the sewage event, or should I do it later?
Certainly could.
Because it impacts on the big picture items we've been discussing, and I think this is one. And part of the Elizabeth White submission included items from the Water Council to look at water and sewage issues on island. And actually, it was something that I started looking at as a director of the Chamber of Commerce about a year ago. And it's important because it impacts on virtually everyone on island. And there are a number of current topics that also speak to that particular issue. And they include short-term and secondary suites, for example. The impact on septics and sewage systems on islands is important. Burgoyne Bay is now inactive. It's been shut down. So any of our septic sludge must be removed from island. It's not treated on island anymore. That substantially increased the cost for emptying tanks and disposing of it. And I think there is room for an examination of how we treat sewage on island as a whole, from single-family dwellings right through to overstressed plants like Malleview and like sewage sludge, whether we take it off island or whether we should be trying to do something with it on island. I have had outline discussions with Wayne McIntyre, and I actually prepared an outline paper on this, and he is very keen to have a joint trust or trustee CRD initiative to look at this whole issue, to examine what's best practice in terms of technology and environmentally, to see if there is scope, for example, for using as many natural systems, such as constructed wetlands, to act as pollution buffers and to ameliorate runoff and those sorts of things. And there is an outline agreement between myself and CRD director to try and construct an event that would happen later this year. And it would be late summer, early autumn, probably in the autumn, at a time when the weather's still reasonable, but there is more available space in hotel rooms. And we would have a weekend event, probably, with lectures, with submission papers, with discussions and debates and town halls on this whole issue. And it might help us to... The current technology we adopt in terms of septics is old. It's obsolete. It's the type 1 septic system. It's not best practice. They last about 25 years. And then you have to renew your field. Are there better ways? And I think we can look at that as a community, as a big picture item. And I would really like this to be part of our community engagement process, to see how we involve the community in a big picture item discussion like this. I'm prepared to take this on as a trustee, but I would like the trust or the local trust committee to enter an arrangement with CRD so we partner with them on this event. And I would like to seek LTC approval to obtain staff's assistance to see how we can construct this and possibly make it happen later this year. We would try and minimise staff's involvement by using substantially community-based resources, including tapping into CRD quite heavily. But no doubt there would be some staff involvement.
Exciting.
Well, it could be. Yeah. If you think about the topic, it's not very exciting, but it is to some people. Harry gave us the book on human manure, for example. So he has a pressing interest in it. It's the sort of thing that it's out of sight. You bury a tank, you flush, and you don't think about it for the next 60 years. But it's really important. And things are happening beneath the surface. Rather than simply leave the initiative to CRD, I think this is a joint initiative because it impacts on our water, as I said, secondary suites. This is where the interrelationship of different programs and policies, I think, really comes to bear. And I think examining this, particularly in a joint venture with CRD, because we haven't had too many of those, offers the opportunity, I think, for broad community participation and hopefully a consensual way forward in this issue.
George, it's hugely important, and I really am pleased for taking this initiative. The septic systems, I'm told, by the way, that we use were invented by the Romans, and there's been very little change, I gather, in the technology since then. But, you know, particularly our concerns about water, what's happening on Cushon Lake and St. Mary Lake, we talk about the septic field issues there. It's got to be raised in terms of the community awareness, and I think this would be a marvellous way of doing it. I think it's a way of bringing some people onto the island, helping our tourism, if you like, because I can see this as a really big event. I think it'll bring people from across British Columbia and certainly Vancouver Island if we do it right. It's going to require a lot of time in terms of organising and marketing and such, but I think it can be done. I think it'd be really, really beneficial to the island.
Thank you. It could also involve other trust areas.
Yeah. Well, it is an advocacy statement in the Islands Trust policy statement that other agencies look at changing their regulations to enable just the kind of stuff that our constituents and we are asking for, but the health authority hasn't been amenable, and getting a more grassroots push would be terrific. It's something that you might consider advocating as a strategic plan objective for Trust Council, because it would carry out, it would be done on Salt Spring Good, but may well be able to be supported, whether it's in budget or staff resources, more broadly than just here, because it does carry out something that's in the policy statement, and it's certainly consistent with advocacy statements in Salt Springs OCP. You know, it's clear that it's the CRD that is the servicing agency, and it's the province that is the regulating agency. The Trust Committee would simply be an advocate and a supporter, but I think it would be an important voice to be there. So are you proposing bringing something to the next meeting that's got more, you know, parameters around it that the Trust Committee could sort of sign on to in principle?
Well, as I said, I have an outline paper that I prepared, and I think Leah has a copy of that. You now have a copy. I believe Peter has a copy. It's essentially been agreed with CRD. It's fluid at the moment.
As it were.
Because whoever the stakeholders are in this, and we haven't agreed them all, but I think we want to involve as broad a spectrum from the community as possible, then I would like them to be able to influence the content as well. So we haven't crystallized that, but it has been, the bones of it have been established, and I can certainly circulate that. Wayne McIntyre can speak to it in his the CRD director statement later today. He sees it as a very important and crucial aspect of our infrastructure and working with Trust and with other community groups, and he's very much in support of it. So I'm planning it. It's underway. I'm looking at possible the best means of actually arranging it, and whether it's a steering committee or a management committee, and who the possible participants in that structure might be. I've approached some, and they cover landscape architects who might contribute to issues such as constructed wetlands, and how useful they would be as pollution buffers around Cushion Lake, to and some very eminent landscape architects, I might add, to hydrologists, to North Salt Spring Water Works general manager, I think should be included in the committee. Wayne, obviously, McIntyre, CRD director, or one of his delegates. I would like to involve Mark Wyatt, who was a candidate in the election, because Mark organises events. I mean, that's what he does for a living, and I think Mark can bring a commercial dimension to this that might make it wash its face. And so his advice on how to make this an event that taps into the resources of island taxpayers as little as possible could add a kind of helpful dimension in terms of fiscal prudence. So, and it's not the complete list yet, but it's the bones of one are there. So that's as far as I have. I've taken it. But if I can't get LTC consent, then I will take it forward as a trustee. But I'd prefer if we can have broader trust involvement.
I can't imagine why you won't get LTC consent. If I was sitting in the planning manager's seat, I'd be thinking to myself, you know, what is being talked about here in terms of staff time? So I think that'll be pretty important to identify what kind of help, if any, will be required from staff. Because that, presumably, would be on your list of concerns.
Yes, and I think we can follow up as it develops to discern if this is part of the community engagement pilot or if this is something that is broader than Salt Spring itself and should be dealt with essentially under a different budget. It does ring a lot of bells true, both with the official community plan and the strategic plan of Islands Trust. So let's talk further.
So if you're able, just for public transparency reasons, if you're able to get something on to the next agenda, mm-hmm. then people will know that we're considering this. And if you're able to talk with the planning manager around what sort of decision, whether it's a work program, fitting into the work program, or whether it's a bigger initiative that you'd like us to endorse in principle, 3 weeks from now, then that would be very good.
Okay.
And no one's putting up any roadblocks, so I think you're going to get good signals.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, very interesting. And a nice collaboration as well. Where were we? We were in the middle of another conversation, though, weren't we? About the gas tax question. So is that a recommendation to not pursue the gas tax funding as the delegate had recommended to us?
At this point, we can't. At LTC, we can't get anything in by the end of May. So yes.
Okay. And anything from the planning manager on that?
So sorry, you're looking worried. I mean,
you were looking thoughtful. If LTC is in agreement, I think we should record that that will conclude our involvement at this stage.
So
we'll ask the minutes show that that Trustee Grove reported on the delegate request around gas tax funding from 3 weeks ago, and the consensus is the timeline is too tight for the trust committee to apply for the May 31st gas tax funding.
Well said. Thank you.
Good. And I guess the other thing is it's not something, this is again a sorting mechanism. It's not to do with secondary suites and it's not to do with RAR mapping. And so we really do need to be focused on top priorities around grant applications as well. Mm-hmm. Thank you both to the staff and to Trustee Grove for pursuing that. That is the end of the follow-up action list. We're moving then into... There's a suggestion that we not look at correspondence right now. Is that okay?
I've noted that the last discussion went a little bit over time, and if we want a lunch break, we might need to defer something to the afternoon.
Good.
And unless anyone's here to deal with correspondence, that might be the best thing to defer to the afternoon.
I don't see any letter writers in the audience. Okay. With the trustees' consent, can we move the Section 5 into the afternoon part of the agenda and move to Section 6?
Mm-hmm.
That takes us to page 45 of the agenda. Item 6.1 is the 2012 Development Applications Report. And I'll ask the planning manager to introduce that briefly.
Madam Chair, this is by special request of LTC. At last meeting, when we reported on the number of applications received in the first quarter of 2012, there was a question if we could quickly put together a comparable list from neighboring islands. And so this is provided for your information. I want to acknowledge the work of Caitlin Brownrigg in putting this together quickly in response to that request. Myself, looking at it, I see I can't recommend any pattern because I see some of the neighboring jurisdictions similar to us. Obviously, a slowdown showing in the first quarter of this of this year. Other islands seem to have a real spurt on in terms of, of development activities. So it's something that perhaps I can discuss further with my colleagues, or that trustees might want to discuss with other trustees through the spring, and we will certainly monitor this on Salt Spring.
That's interesting.
Good.
Any reflections or observations from the
I think it's deceptive. I think there's activity below the surface that is going to bubble forward in due course. And I think, as always, there's a delay between conceptualizing and something hitting the trust office as an application. But certainly, judging by the number of telephone calls and whatnot that I've received, there's concealed activity that, that will emerge in due course.
Yeah, it's interesting. I know where I appreciate why there's not tracking of building permit referrals, partly because not every trust committee gets them. Gabriola, for example, doesn't. But building permits are really busy in our region, so it really does. There are peaks and valleys for sure. Very good. Can we move to the next item, 6.2, applications log on page 47. Do trustees have any questions on particular items in the applications log? And would the planning manager like to draw our attention to any new applications that have come in?
Are we going through these on a page by page?
Why don't we? Page 47?
What's happening on Park Drive, on page 47, that's Swanson Pond, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. It is.
Perhaps I can throw some light on that. I got an email, I think it was late yesterday, from Wayne Lee confirming that he would be providing the outline confirmation that there is no difficulty with regard to surface water runoff in that lot. That should be furnished within the next couple of days.
Great. That's helpful.
But the last comment here is that, and of which we are aware, of course, is that he doesn't want to provide security before issuance of the DP. So what's happening about that? And that's, he doesn't want to do it, so where are we?
That's our decision.
Right.
It'll come back to
us. So it'll come back here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything on page 48? 49?
I'd say, what's happening on Norton Road, do we know?
Yes, Lee and I had a meeting with Tom Connor,
yes,
to clarify certain issues, and I think they were satisfied with the answers they were given, and they are preparing a revised housing agreement or a draft for consideration. I understand that's current situation.
So when will it likely come back to LTC?
We don't know. It's in their court. Mm.
This is one that is post-public hearing, and we're simply waiting for the legal agreement to come forward and to be approved by LTC, at which point in time they can conclude the zoning approval.
Okay.
But we are not reporting a lot of the discussion in between, as it in order not to introduce new information to LTC.
This is probably an example in the applications log where it is helpful after all this time to say that the bylaw process has completed.
Yeah.
And we don't get that signal from what's written here.
Yes.
Trustee Grove?
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Page 49, any questions? Page 50.
No, 51.
Yes, my only concern with regard to John Quinnell is an update on the industrial land on the on Planner Cermak's work on the industrial land search, because I know he's doing it specifically for this file, but also in general terms.
Any comments from the planning manager here?
Planner Cermak met with the Economic Development Commission last week, and I believe also met with directors of the Chamber of Commerce sometime in the last 2 weeks, engaging and drawing in some of the perspectives regarding industrial sites and waste management sites. So as Trustee Grove said, a more generic discussion other than this one, but that will help to inform this particular application. And I believe he's also been in contact with economic development officers with the provincial government that just to bring in kind of a broader perspective to the that he'll bring back to you on.
Good,
this.
Great, thank you. Kings Lane, I noticed the rep on that file here with us today. What's happening?
This application shows in March there was a discussion on accessory uses. Sorry, let me go down just a little bit further. It was January that we gave first reading and got the initial referrals out to agencies. Two of the agencies withheld comments, or we didn't even send the referrals until there was a traffic impact assessment. And that assessment came early March and is still being vetted by the Ministry of Transportation. We were a bit delayed in getting it to the Ministry of Transportation in order to have their comments back and bring this today. So we anticipate that next step is to bring back a synthesis of referral comments, any issues or questions that are arising from the referral comments we will bring to LTC to deliberate on, and at that time we can give second reading to the bylaw and proceed to public hearing. The this records a sidebar discussion that the applicant has raised with the planner, seeking clarity of definition of accessory uses as permitted in the draft bylaw. It's the standard CF1 zone, or using the standard terminology in CF1 zone. And we note that this application originally came in and was caught up during a change in terms. So it's one that we would like to see direction given to schedule public hearing as quickly as possible after second reading. So if trustees have questions about that, perhaps we can talk some options about the timing and processing.
What are the options?
Well, I think if we had the response back from Ministry of Transportation last week, we would have attempted to bring this forward for your deliberation today. We'll certainly get it back for mid-May, even if we're delayed in Ministry of Transportation. I note that if we wait till the mid-May to give direction on scheduling of public hearing, that would occur at the end of June. We normally have minimum 4 weeks because of the notification, but we typically take between 5 and 7 weeks between giving direction for public hearing to proceeding with public hearing. So I think if, by way of your discussion today, if we know that you are going to want to schedule that public hearing as quickly as possible, and we can certainly pass on that message to our administrative staff that we anticipate your resolution mid-May and should perhaps have the advertising ready to go and get to public hearing as quickly as possible following that meeting.
I would certainly like to see it sped up. I mean, I feel that we are somewhat responsible for this delay that's taking place for various administrative reasons. So, yeah, I'd like to push this forward as quickly as possible. That's all right.
I think there's a sense of urgency from the medical fraternity on Ireland to get this resolved too.
And if the agency comments result in recommendation for bylaw draft or proposed bylaw amendments, then you can always slow down the public hearing. But I certainly like the intention of saying that the we don't want to be the ones holding this up.
Right.
Thank you.
Is there? Do we anticipate a hold up because of this accessory use issue? Is there anything that can be done to, in advance, is what I'm trying to say, to make sure that it doesn't hold it all up?
I think that the applicant is interested in having some certainty. You may be presented with an optional amendment to the bylaw at second reading to give greater certainty around accessory uses. I, not having been party to the discussions between the planner and the applicant, I wouldn't want to try and discuss that today or dialogue around that today. Yeah. I think you'd probably want to see the planner's report and hear from the applicant about this. The applicant is in the audience today if you wanted to have questions, but I would encourage that you'd want to wait till you have the staff report.
I think I'll take your advice on that.
So one staff report, any recommendations for changes to the proposed bylaw will all come at one time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Thanks. Yeah. Anything on page 51? This is the new rezoning application that you mentioned?
Yes.
Around the falafel hut?
Mm-hmm.
We might do something a bit more descriptive on the name of...
Yes.
Or the purpose or something.
I'm sorry. I'm not... What are you referring to?
2012.1, the top of page 51, says Eric Booth, but it's actually the falafel hut.
Yeah. Oh, that's what you said.
Yes.
Al's falafels. We'll get that added to the description.
Any questions, page 51?
No.
52? The rest of these are all subdivisions, skip right to the end unless you'd like to slow
that's
us
fine.
Down. All right. Thank you. If we can move then to 6.3, the Trust Committee expense budget allocations. The trustees have any questions on this?
I have, but do we want to hear from the planning manager first?
Sure.
Yes, this is a standard, a routine action that our finance staff asks for LTC to turn its mind to at the start of each fiscal year. You've been given an LTC local expense budget, which is intended to support your meetings and any special projects that you conduct during the year. And I'll note this is separate from the earlier report talking the OCP LUB budget. This is called the Local Trust Committee Expense Budget. So it is a total amount routinely given to Salt Spring. This year, it's a typical amount of $31,500. I note that with the increased frequency of LTC meetings this year, we're suggesting that you will want to apportion an increased amount. And we suggest you would want 28% of that budget earmarked to support the expenses of the LTC meetings. We are perhaps fortunate that we have Lions Hall booked for the year. This is definitely a suitable location and very cost-effective, thanks to the generosity of the service club. The other thing that I draw your attention to is in special projects, the video recording that you are expected to commission for the year will draw from this account, and if you wish any special projects that are over and above the OCP budget, they would draw from this account. Until you have a quote in hand for a year of video recording, you may wish to not be undertaking any draws from special projects or avoid it as much as possible until you know what your video recording costs will be for the year.
That's good advice.
But you're anticipating about $12,000 for video recording, I believe.
Until we receive the quotes, we
really don't know.
Yeah, we thought 12,000 plus the extra storage costs. And when I give the verbal report, I think I can talk a little bit more about the storage costs.
So. But if it were 12,000, that would leave us $4,000 in that account, plus $1,500
for the
balance. So $5,500 to go crazy with.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, well, that'll go a long way, George. Anyhow, my bigger question was, I don't understand how this ties in with page 18, the Salt Spring Region budget, which altogether adds up to $97,000, of which $45,000 is mapping, which leaves $52,000. And is this a separate budget altogether?
It's a separate budget, yeah. Each trust committee has what's called a local expense budget, which is allocated using a formula based on population and number of properties and so on. So Gabriola, for example, has 10,000, and it's the next best endowed trust committee on local expense. So it's meant to cover your minute taking costs. You get this every year.
Okay.
And then what we've been looking at earlier in the agenda on page 18, that was what was specially voted on in the new budget. And that will change from year to year.
Okay.
But
and
this is a fixed.
If we go back to page 18 for a moment, we can apply to shift those monies around. I think the planning manager's notes would suggest.
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's right.
I mean, our overall budget is 50, on that sheet is $97,000, and we could apply to shift it back.
Yeah, and it doesn't interact with this budget that we're looking at adopting.
And changes to that would have to go to council for approval.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how that works, but to me it makes sense for us to figure out what it is we want to do,
and then
in the meantime we can be sure how to.
I have no plans. I just want to understand how it works.
Yeah.
But is that right, Leah? That the monies under the Salt Spring Region budget amounting to $97,000. We've got an outline here of how it has been approved by council, but we can go back to council and request a shift.
Yes. To date, we've not returned to council to make the shifts. There is a council policy that allows shifts within the OCP LUB budget, which is the $14,000. The strategic projects budget, we draw from a pool attached to local planning services, not attached to Salt Spring. So LTC would have to make requests to change things around under the strategic projects budget.
All right.
And we're seeking guidance on where that request goes, how it is considered.
Anyway, that's good. I had thought the two were combined somehow into separate budgets, and that gives us a bit of breathing room.
And then in addition, you've also got a local trustee expense budget, which I think is something like $3,000 or something like that. It's rarely spent. Trustees tend not to spend it somehow. But I'm pretty sure you can use that kind of thing for if you yourself want to have a meeting with constituents and you want to rent the hall. I mean, it's worth having a look at that policy because it's often a pool of money that we don't end up using.
So each LTC meeting, we now get an update on this, I believe.
Finance sends a report once a month.
Okay.
So it's not every meeting, but as soon as we have the report, then we'll put it into the next agenda package.
And could that report also have the local trustee accounts as well?
You could make that request through Financial Planning Committee.
Please, so that we get this all on one sheet whenever it arrives.
Yeah.
So
and it does, I'm pretty sure that's what we
I
get
think
already.
It does too.
Yeah, it's got both items on it.
What you have in this report is you don't have the printout on this report. This report is intended to provide you with the basis to make allocations.
Good.
And there's a standard wording recommendation here that we would encourage you to make that resolution today so that finance can set up its accounts with the amount that you've dedicated to each of these items.
My point is it needs to be a standard part of our of our meeting package, so that
so this is last month's report, right. So that's what we would expect to get. What's the budget for local expense? What was spent? What remains? And then for each of these categories that we're looking at, what has been spent? What remains?
And that would and that report also covers the Salt Spring region budget as well.
It does.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay, that's spendable. That's good. Thank you.
So that was page 45 of the April 5 agenda package, if anybody's following along. Mm-hmm. And as the planning manager flags, it might not show in every agenda package because we're the only trust committee that's meeting every 3 weeks. But it's always emailed to you in any case, so you'll have it. Does anybody have any changes to propose to the budget that's recommended on page 62?
I have none.
And is anybody willing to move the resolution, which is written on page 61?
I'm happy to move that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee allocates its 2012-13 local expense budget to general ledger codes as follows. 28% to LTC meeting expenses, 5% to advisory committee meeting expenses, 10% to communications, 52% to projects, and 5% to miscellaneous.
Is there a seconder?
Sorry, seconder.
Is there any discussion? And the minute taker, you are with us? Yes. Are you ready to vote? All those in favor? Passes unanimously. Thanks very much. We are moving then to item 6.4, Local Trust Committee video recording, verbal update.
Okay, Madam Chair. On April 5th, there was a staff report which provided results of the pilot program and a bit of evaluation. The although it wasn't recorded, I think staff have concluded that LTC is generally supportive of the video recording service, and that upon consideration of some details and getting a new request for proposals out in a new contract set, this is something that you're interested in offering as a part of your meeting resources and meeting services. The direction on April 5th was to ask staff to explore options, including the use of local media, in order to continue the video recording service and to seek legal advice regarding ways to avoid censorship. And we did a bit of background work immediately after this and looked at a few more precedents. Had a meeting with Gulf Islands Media Publisher at the end of last week. And before meeting with us, the publisher had discussed this a couple of times with the legal counsel that advises the Driftwood. And what the discussion with the Driftwood, or with the publisher, noted is that any media production will, on rare occasions, be edited. That there are laws with respect to libel that are very familiar to people in the media business, and that they, of course, draw upon their own legal counsel with respect to when something needs to be omitted from publication because of those laws. And I should note that I received similar input from two other media sources. I didn't rely just on the comments from Driftwood. Driftwood also indicated that they appreciated being invited to submit a bid on the pilot. They've certainly been interested in how the pilot has unfolded. And they would certainly welcome inclusion in a new invitation to quote on a year-long service. One of the things that came through in the discussion was that Islands Trust may benefit from putting the matters of addressing libel in the contract
scope of work in the terms that there will be expectation that the person undertaking the contract is familiar with the laws of libel and will be giving thought to that at the time of preparing the material for production. I think it's fair to say that members of the media that have expressed opinion on this have also expressed the opinion that they thought that Islands Trust did not need to edit the comments, the particular comments that were made. In their opinion, they would have given some thought to whether they needed to be edited or not. In their experience, we might have been erring on the side of caution. But I think the key message for me coming out of this is that we have opportunity to put into the contract itself expectation that the contractor is going to bring some experience in using these and in using the applying the laws with respect to libel and slander, which is something I think we hadn't thought about before and bears merit. There was another discussion that was going on and actually reflects more to why we made a big edit rather than a small, just leap out some comments or something. Why did we cut a large portion of a tape? And that is the size of the digital files that are being recorded. And that relates to, that has implications both in terms of editing post-production, but also has implications with respect to our costs for storing copies of the recordings, which apparently we store two ways. We store the original digital copy on our server, but as with all other critical files of Islands Trust, to date we have been doing a backup tape as well. And I know there was question at the table 3 weeks ago of why would we be doing a tape, and apparently we do that for critical files as a do a backup tape and store off in a premises outside of our offices. So that's what that was all about. And the larger the file size, the better quality we have, the more expensive the more expenses that are involved with the hardware and the time it takes to get the recordings up for production. So that was an important kind of sidebar discussion that we had. There's one other important thing about it. One of the discussions has been when the new Islands Trust website is up, could we move the display from YouTube where it is now and post it on the website? And I think that was our expectation. With the files, the size they are right now, and somewhere I have so many terabytes. I mean, apparently these are so large, they're bigger than the megabytes or gigabytes, they're terabytes now. If they are that size, a 2 or 3 hour video production to that quality could not be viewed on our new website by multiple viewers. As soon as you got, a really popular item that everyone was waiting for Wednesday night to go and look at, our system would not support the multiple views of that large file at the same time. So if the files remain that large, if the digital recording remains that large, we have to report that our new web is not engineered to support that. So we a couple of options that are now under discussion with our IS support person or IT support person is there ways that the contractor could reduce the recording quality down to, if we went down to DVD quality, it would be in about a 90% reduction in the file size. And I am told that there would be no discernible difference
in the web display or the audio quality. So those perhaps have a lot of merit and maybe things that we want to spell out if we go back out for to a new proposal call. So that's a lot. Sorry to have presented that verbally instead of having it all together a week ago for a written report. Next steps, I'll go to the final bullet first. We're at we need a new resolution from you to allow us to continue videotaping until a new contract is awarded, or at least for another month. A new contract will not be let and awarded before your next meeting. So that resolution at the end is one I definitely ask you to turn your attention to. The two top bullets I think are alternatives for you or options for you to consider, and you may have more questions before you're comfortable making a decision. The first one, if you are comfortable with the information that has come back to you today, and if that answers the essential questions, you may wish to go back and give the nod to staff to do a call for proposals. And we will issue that once we have a resolution from you saying that you do dedicate the funds for 12-month service. Or if based on what you hear today, you have additional comments, if you are seeking specific legal review on any one item, then you can spell that out today and we'll go about seek that and bring that back to May and allow you to proceed at that time.
Trustee Grove.
We asked that staff go to seek legal advice from the trust's mm-hmm. lawyers as to how the trust can protect itself from being sued. What was their response?
We did not go to the lawyers with respect to that. My understanding was we thought there may be a way through posting on a different website or using media to circumvent that. I believe it's just a common thing of any organization in business needs to turn its attention to libel, and we were all are always at risk. The arrangements of the meeting are there are things in there to avoid the risk. There are things that we do in the meeting to caution speakers with respect to matters of libel. But I think by the time that the Driftwood said no, even us at times, under certain circumstances, we must bleep a tape or cut over
part of the tape. I think it's extremely important, as I said at our last meeting, that we get a written recommendation from our lawyers to specifically outlining what we can do. It is my belief, and I don't know if this is true, it's my belief that if a third party make the recording and put it on their website, as is happening right now, depending upon how our contract spells this out, I think the trust can properly be completely protected from liable. But I don't know if this is true. And I see nothing in the first slide that we saw that gives me complete confidence from what you have said that the trust is protected. And I think we have to have legal advice. If for instance, hosting it on our own website, I suspect, is not a good idea from what my understanding is, because it's then very much under the control of the trust, and having it on somebody else's YouTube, for instance, is quite removed.
Okay. So some general rules of thought as to through these steps you reduce your involvement.
Not general rules. A precise legal opinion is what we want.
And that was requested in our previous resolution.
I recognize that the wording of the resolution directs.
And I think it's essential.
Okay.
I'm certainly prepared to extend the current service,
yeah.
But I'm not prepared to press on with seeking for an RFP until we have legal advice.
Okay.
Because that will affect what that RFP mm-hmm. looks like.
Okay. Trustee Grimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's clear what we want. We want a mechanism set up that avoids, that removes the perception that the trust either has the capacity to edit these tapes, because and hosting it on the trust website clearly retains that capacity. They can remove what they want from their own website. It has to be hosted on an external server, in my view, so that we remove that risk. And a contract to be set up, and maybe it's not a contract, maybe it has to be a grant, that we award a grant to someone to record, so that if we have a contract, then the danger with a contract is that we can then instruct the removal of certain segments that might be inconvenient. And I think we want to remove that possibility too, perhaps through a grant as opposed to a contract, where we simply assist some sort of recording process without necessarily defining too tightly the terms. We can ensure that we have every meeting taped, but remove the contractual obligation that would render us legally liable in the event that there's a malicious statement.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I think that gives me the direction I was looking for before drawing our lawyer in.
But I'm happy to extend our presence.
Absolutely, yeah.
So is that all you want from us right now, then?
Don't need a resolution on the lawyer, because I'll just, that rounds out your previous resolution. That last bit in the small print, I do need that from you in order to ensure that we continue to have service next month. So
not with that wording, though. Now, we have now adopted a budget that includes video recording as a special project item.
No, it simply allocates a percentage of the budget right. to special projects.
Okay, so the resolution still needs
yeah.
to be.
Now, since you're not, and I agree, since you're not directing going to RFP, then let's word this the way that we had before. To videotape general business meetings of the LTC through the months of May and June with funds to come from the local expense okay. budget.
So I move then that the Salt Spring Island LTC approve payment of expenses to videotape general business meetings of to be held in May and June
yep.
with the funds to come from the local expense budget for 2012-13.
Seconded.
Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. Step with the minute taker. You want that change?
Sure.
Yeah. The question that I still have before I'm ready to pass a resolution like is on the bottom of the page or for the whole year, I'm still feeling strongly that because the trust committee is not itself going to be involved in who gets the contract, we really need to make sure that the trust committee is on board with what are the elements. This is outside the issues that you've been talking about so far as liability. Are we going to tape the public input session? Who is going to do the editing? How quickly do you want it posted? Do you want it to stay forever? So these are all the issues that were raised in the March 20 report. But I think that the staff need to solicit through the resolution, very specific direction from the trust committee so that we know that it's achieving your objectives and there aren't any surprises.
Okay.
So I think it needs to be specified. Is this for business meetings or all community meetings? Do you want people to be able to watch it the night of the meeting? Is that important?
In my view, that's not important. It's more important that there's a permanent record.
Yes.
And if it assuming it's Monday or Tuesday or next week, that it finds its way onto the web. That's more than adequate. There's nothing particularly urgent that demands it need be posted within 12 or 24 hours. I think the quality is not a huge issue. YouTube quality is adequate. The file sizes don't need to be enormous. I think Peter and I benefit from soft focus. If that can be included,
that was
through more language. Yes. Anyway, I guess what I'm getting at is the whole reason that we did a pilot is so we could test some of these issues.
Yeah.
So I think it's important that both the request for proposals that gets issued to the community specifies the product that we're looking for, and that the trust committee is on board with that, and we're not putting the staff in the position of making judgment calls.
And by the way, I'm really pleased that we had this whole issue during the pilot project process. I mean, I think it's fantastic, and notwithstanding what some people may have to say about it, it's very good that it came to the surface so that we can deal with it.
Well, and the last question I have is, if there is advice that we're obtaining from other sources that indicate that the trust might not be in breach if it hosts that videotape, can we restore the full thing in the interests of transparency and accountability?
What do you mean, can we restore the full
thing? Well, why don't we just post the whole thing again? Why is it?
Oh, from the previous month?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Let's do that.
And we haven't received that advice from our legal team. We have received comment from others.
Well, then let's ask the
legal team. Well, let's ask them specifically.
Because I'd be very happy to put that on. Yeah. That's a very good point, George.
If you're thinking of a legal opinion that would be publicly available, because they sometimes aren't, then it might be helpful to specify that. It would be written in a particular way. I don't even know if this is possible. But
under freedom of information, everyone has access to everything, don't they?
Not legal opinions.
But sometimes where there are complex planning issues, I haven't seen it in this kind of situation, but I have seen, for example, Galliano, which has endless complicated legal situations. Sometimes the request is that a planning legal opinion be written in a way that is known that it is intended for public consumption. And that, if that's a wish of yours, then it may be worth specifying.
Well, I think it's highly desirable that it should be in a form that it is available to the public.
I just find it odd that you would give advice in privately and then tailor it for public consumption. I can't think of any other profession that would do that. Maybe medical advice, but as an architect or an engineer, or would you, if you give advice to a client, and you fully expect it to be put out in the public domain and stand scrutiny.
Well, again, I'm not experienced in this element, but it's more, so you can imagine in the local government sense, you ask the lawyer for a legal opinion about the prospect of your bylaw on home-based business standing up in court. That's not the kind of thing that you then want to have publicly available, because you may be inviting someone to challenge your bylaw. I mean, that's the rationale.
Well,
the prospect of success, or could it have been written tighter? Anyway, there's ways around that. Often the planners get the legal advice, and then they just include it. They reflect it in their
staff reports. Is that enough information that you need?
Yes, and I will ask that they provide something in writing that can be shared with members of the public.
Yes.
I think that will be helpful on this as well.
Thank you.
Do you want that in the form of a resolution, or do you want just that to be shown in the minutes?
Just show it in the minutes.
Okay. So the two items there were ideally the legal opinion we're asking for is something that could be shown to the public, and the second was, is there a prospect of having
the full tape restored?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So ask the minutes show that the trustees would like, ideally, the legal opinion to be available to be shared with the public, and for it to answer the question of whether the full tape in question could be restored.
Thank
Good?
You.
Yes?
Thank
All
you.
Right.
Now, with regards to the design of the whole process, I mean, is this something you wanted to talk about now? For instance, you talked about business meetings or all meetings, whether everyone be recorded. I mean, is this something that would be helpful to talk about, or do you have a list of questions that you need to answer?
Well, I think it's a major deliberation. It's sometimes your special meetings that deal with the most interesting matters of public consultation and public input. So far, we have approached this as you would do your general business meetings. Behind the scenes, we've known, oh boy, okay, the request will come. Do you do your special meetings, for instance, the meetings on the suites? That would have been one that in the past we would have, people would have suggested it would benefit from video recording. And then the next in line would be public hearings, people having interest in having public hearings. Those are separate and distinct meetings, separate and distinct productions. I think you can take your budget per 17 general business meetings and think of how many of special meetings you have during the course of a year, too, and do the math.
But do you want to deal with this now, or when do you want
to
start?
No, but I think that I think when we look at the scope of work or the scope of the contract, I think that is something for you to certainly be very clear about.
So can we have a list of those questions sent to us beforehand so we can think about them?
We can, yeah.
That would be helpful.
Because the issues were all raised in the April 5 staff report and the March 20 report on the pilot, I mean, what I think would be the most helpful for the Trust Committee is if you can outline what you are proposing will go in the call for proposals
Good,
so
yes.
that the bidder knows what they're bidding on.
Yes, yeah.
Is it 17 meetings and what time of day are they and those kind of things.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the Trust Committee is then able to look at those items that you're proposing and say yes or no.
Yes.
And then you're very clear with us, if you want to tape more than 17 meetings a year, you're going to have to save some money in your budget. And when we do schedule special meetings or public hearings, we'll have to think about whether. So is that fair? So I think if it all is in the one staff report that we look at, then it will be tidier for all of us and there won't be any surprises on the contractor and the staff.
Well, then keep that on your priority
list
because it's going to be more than 2 hours of work.
Yeah. Well, again, you have a lot of them in the previous staff report. You just haven't challenged us to make any decisions about it yet.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, we are now at the end of our morning agenda. By consent, can we break for 20 minutes for lunch and we'll be back in our seats at noon for the public session? Thank you.
Thank you.